Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. It's not too late to say Happy New Year, I think, and the start of a semester, a great new semester on this beautiful, sunny, snowy day. It's a real pleasure to see so many of you here, and thank you for joining us for this inaugural event in the Dean's Series on Race and Policy at SEPA. This is one of several initiatives that we have launched this year to broaden our engagement around issues of race and public policy, race and social justice. And through this series, really we're bringing world-renowned experts, scholars, thought leaders to SEPA to share their perspectives on this really important subject, to engage with our community, our students, our faculty, and others about a subject area that we care about deeply. We've seen very intense public debate in the United States and indeed around the world around race and policy, and particularly in light of the grand jury decisions in the Brown and Garner cases. And ours is an intellectual environment, I think, that welcomes, that needs to welcome that debate and deeper engagement. And in this speaker series, with input from SEPA students, we are bringing in, I think, outstanding experts, and we are also launching new courses on race and policy, and we're strengthening and supporting the work of the Diversity Task Force, which was established last year to build greater understanding, to take on additional activities, and to address important and timely subjects. Today's lecture is the first of what will, I hope, be a full slate of activities this spring and into the fall. We have several other lectures already scheduled. And what better way to launch this seminar series than welcoming a scholar and author of the stature of Professor Patricia Williams to SEPA. Thank you very, very much for joining us. Her lecture is entitled The Death of Contingency, Risk, Race, and Rue. And to introduce her more fully, I'm pleased to welcome our own Vice Dean, Professor Miguel Urquiella. Thank you, Miguel. And thank you, Professor.
Thanks, Merit. Well, as you know, by its very nature, SEPA is, of course, interested in engages policy issues. At the same time, SEPA is part of a major research university, and therefore we basically seek deep and cutting-edge thought on the issues that we engage. It is difficult often to find a person that combines these two interests very clearly, and so we're most grateful to have Patricia Williams this afternoon. She's the James Dohr Professor of Law here at Columbia. She's a graduate of Wellesley College and Harvard Law School, and has had faculty-related affiliations at numerous institutions, including Dartmouth, the University of Wisconsin, CUNY, Golden Gate Universities, places around the country, basically. She has published widely on topics that include race, gender, and the law, with books that include, and I'll cite two of them here, Alchemy of Race and Rights, and Seeing a ColorBlind Future. These have been very well reviewed and have had very large impacts. In addition to this academic trajectory, she has been a deputy city attorney in LA, and is a member of the State Bar of California and the Federal Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit. For this work, she has received numerous awards, including recently a MacArthur Fellowship. I could most certainly go on and on, but the point is not to hear me. So with that, let me repeat that we're most grateful to have her. And without further delay, let me please ask you to join me in welcoming Patricia Williams.
Thank you. It's such a pleasure to be here. I want to thank the Dean and Miguel and all of you for coming. I must say, first of all, that this class, this time period actually overlaps with my class, and so I know that there are some of my students who are actually here. I teach two classes, Anatomy of Autonomy and Human Identity, Justice, and the Scientific Revolution. So the title, Death of Risk, to some extent plugs into the question of risk, which is the subject of my human identity and technology class. And actually, in the interest of time, I am not going to spend as much time with that as I might, and for those of my students who are in that seminar, I will come back to that in class. The remainder of this is I think, the remainder of the title, Race, Risk, and Rue. The immediate question I got was rue, and I mean our, not what makes a lovely gumbo, but but regret, the question of regret. The degree to which profiling in particular creates an environment which pre-identifies us and is in tension, I think, with some of the jurisprudential models that we grow up with as the ideals by which we are constructed as individuals, as autonomous individuals. And I think we're at a precarious moment in not just American history or American jurisprudence, but globally in terms of the reconfiguration of, for example, just in criminal, let's just take criminal law, where if you, where our jurisprudence is on cases and controversies, and when you are encountered in the street, it is based on something you have done, not something that you will do. Well, we are certainly at a moment when technology, surveillance, and profiling have come together so that really we are looking at what you are likely to do. So we have become actuarial for purposes of policing. Our policing, in addition, has merged to some degree with the militarization or the spy functions of our governments. And our governments have expanded for through the use of internet technology, it's obvious to state this, but nevertheless, the repercussions of this, I think, are going to be even much more profound in terms of our ability to move in the world. The idea that every police officer is also an international eye upon our lives. So, for me, it is sort of intriguing to think about the consequences of this. And again, against a backdrop where I think I also put into some of my note to Miguel the sense that I've been traveling back and forth just for, not for research, but just for my own pleasure, but I happened to be in France at the time that Ferguson really blew up. I happened to be in the Midwest at the time that the Charlie Hebdo material was unfolding. And so I guess I want to sort of look at all of the issues I've just laid out in terms of from Ferguson to France and France to Ferguson. So some of what I want to cover is, again, this question of our actuarial selves, and some of what I want to cover has to do with our with the question of what is being punished, particularly when it comes to the question of speech. And how that will get us flagged. Now, I want to, where shall I start? I'll start with a letter I got just yesterday, which has gotten under my skin so much that I need to read it to you to get it out. Dear Professor Williams, I think I've seen you on TV once or twice. I occasionally peruse The Nation magazine, although I am a moderate conservative. And regarding Ferguson-related, I found your column in the December issue less annoying than some other pieces I've read. So you can see why already I'm sort of twitchy. He says, long ago I was held up in Hyde Park while a graduate student. I lost only a watch. A graduate school chum was stabbed in the liver on not promptly handing over his wallet. It is a simple fact, and it would take too much time and space for either of us to pursue just what the root causes may or may not be, or to argue about the general status of terms like root cause, that crime in some areas is overwhelmingly perpetrated by young black males. Given this, would it really make sense, be good not only for white people but also black people, if in such places the police were instructed that they stop for even casual inspection one race or the other in proportion to its presence in the general population? I think that at a minimum, valuable time and resources would be diverted if inspection according to proportion in the population were required, and that crime, therefore, would decrease. Now, there's so much wrong with this, I don't even know where to begin. What really bothered me was that this particular person who wrote this, who shall remain nameless, is nevertheless a tenured scientist, a professor, not here, but at a university, a very well-named university in the South, and he goes on to talk about the scientific method of proportionally policing. And yet at the same time, that is absolutely not. If we were really talking about proportional policing, there would be no problem. If we were actually talking about the fact that, yes, in certain areas, more crimes are committed by young black men, it was true in black areas where most black people live. Given our segregation, more black crimes are going to be committed by young black men. And in white areas, you are going to find many more crimes committed by white people than black people because we live in a very segregated society. To me, the real issue is A, the disproportion rather than the proportion of policing, and B, the fact of what is defined as a crime or not given exactly the same facts. And so just to keep our eye on the ball, the problem is that approximately 80% of African American men between 16 and 24 have endured unsolicited stops by the New York City Police Department, just in our city. And this is a figure that is replicated variously to varying degrees, but this is our city. 80% of African American men between 16 to 24 endured unsolicited stops by the NYPD. Only 10% of white young men in the same age cohort have. And this doesn't reflect inherent criminality. In fact, only 6% of those stops ever result in arrest. And only 6% of those arrests ever result in any kind of conviction. So we're talking about a huge number of young men who get sifted through on the search for criminality that simply is not the same experience for young white men. So if there's a disproportion, even in the numbers of arrests and convictions, already we're talking about a sort of feeding into the sifter that is deeply, deeply disproportionate. So again, it does not reflect inherent criminality, but rather a pattern of discrimination as a matter of policy. This is not about the police. This is from the higher-ups. This is how, this is the decision to focus most of your policing and your police officers in one area as opposed to another. Now, to observe that much, and to discuss it and to push to change it is not the equivalent of stoking hatred. And I'm really concerned about this because that is certainly what Patrick Lynch has said in this city, but it's also what's beginning to be said, and it's certainly what has been said in Britain, in London, in the wake of the riots a couple of years ago. And now it's beginning to be said in very crude terms in France as well, and that worries me. I'll just read you another letter. Do you genuinely believe that the activities of Al Sharpton over decades have not served to exacerbate racial tensions? Although it must be virtually impossible to prove, I suspect that his rhetoric, as well as the activities of some partisans of the old and new left, contributed to property damage as well as loss of life in Ferguson. Doubtless many innocent black people suffered thereby as well. So Al Sharpton becomes, like mayor, like our mayor, sort of the agent of property loss and actual death, which again worries me because you see this collapse, this conversation in the wake of Charlie Hebdo and the power of speech about whether or not speech is actually the same as the act of killing. And certainly we in the West, by and large, have separated the notion of symbol and conduct, actual violent conduct. But I want to consider the question of blasphemy, because I think that we do have a location of blasphemy in our culture, even though it's not necessarily that of religion. And so I want to approach it from a kind of I'm going to try this out in terms of you in this audience because you're so interdisciplinary. I've spent a little time in France, not a great deal of time, but enough to know that Charlie Hebdo's had a ceaseless reign of nearly always sexual, relentlessly vulgar, profane by all measure depictions. And the question is what that telegraphed, because it certainly didn't just offend the world of Islam. And what did it telegraph, not just to the world, but to deeply divided worlds, the plural worlds of human imagination? And what is or isn't has been carefully, if not consciously, curated by our culture, by the familiar, by the known. Some media have reproduced the most controversial cartoons. And we had a lot of conversation in our newspapers about reproducing, whether we should reproduce or not. And many, like the New York Times, decided not, that they had editorial discretion not to reproduce absolutely everything that came down the pike. Some viewed that as censorship or fear. Regardless of what it is, I just want to place that next to the fact that what we did not censor, we did not have any conversation about, was reproducing over and over and over again the image of that police officer being killed, of his body dying, of the twitching of that body. It was reproduced over and over and over again. And I wonder the extent to which we ought to be having a conversation about the visibility of violence and what that, if not the cartoons, but what the visualization of violence in our society is as it relates to the ingestion, the psychic dynamic of what makes us afraid or not, and whether or not the repetitive perpetuation of certain issues, if not of certain images, not necessarily cartoons, but particularly violent images in our culture, is not something that we may want to think about, again, not to suppress or not to censor, but with the same sort of editorial eye that we might have or think about. And really think about the impact on our psyche. So, let me just, I want to put that issue out and make a little bit of a leap here. I was listening to the coverage of the attacks in Paris a few weeks ago. It was against that backdrop that you heard Mayor Bill de Blasio saying that there was blood on the hands, or Patrick Lynch saying there was blood on the hands of Mayor de Blasio. George Pataki, our former governor, called the killings the, quote, predictable outcome of divisive anti-cop rhetoric. Do you remember this when Brinsley killed two police officers in front of in front of a storefront just a few weeks ago? There was a direct conflation of the political discourse of Mayor de Blasio's campaign or of the newspapers and the act of a man who actually had schizophrenia. And I was really interested, again, in that collapse between the notion of what is spoken and the agency of a man who actually, in psychiatric terms, had no agency. But that it then became used for political purposes to assign responsibility and effectively say that we shouldn't be talking about policing strategy. Now, at the same time, there's another category of political speech I want to look at, which is just what's buried in the meaning of words themselves, or how we the unconscious nature of what we speak. This is something I heard that many of you may have heard or followed in the newspapers. It got a great deal of coverage outside the country. I don't know how much coverage it got within the country, which was Chris Cuomo, our former governor's son, not our governor, not our present governor, but Chris Cuomo, our governor's brother at this moment, is a correspondent for CNN, and he made a quite revealing gaffe. And this is what he said. Three hostage takers dead. He's in Paris reporting on the massacres there. Three hostage takers dead. That calculus are the two brothers who were taken out and the African-American man who'd been pictured as a suspect in a separate shooting yesterday. And Anderson Cooper was with him, and Anderson Cooper said, not American, the man of African descent. So, no, it's funny, because I've said this to a number of friends and people don't even hear it, by and large, in the United States, which is why I actually bring it up, because I have said this a number of times to a number of friends, and people don't hear it. Oh, well, you know, the African-American man. Well, no, he was not American. Now, Amedy Coulibaly, the man in question, in fact, was French. He wasn't even African in that sense. He was certainly born and bred. He was African-descended. He was born and bred in France, if at the conceptual difference of the very miserable banlieue to which the French, who really know how to live beautifully, but nevertheless they have confined so many of their darker-skinned populations in these horrible areas. Now, while it is true, in some sense, again, that Coulibaly was African-descended, that designation literally whitewashes the degree to which his murderousness seems to have erupted against a very particular colonial backdrop. Coulibaly's parents were born in Mali, although the French press widely referred to his background as Senegalese. And his wife, I don't know if you remember that his wife, I don't know how much of this really came across on television, but his wife, her name was Hayat Boumediene, which is a very Algerian name. But in the United States, by many people, she was seen as white. His co-conspirators, seen by, you know, and honestly, the Kouachi brothers, and honestly, I was really waiting for somebody at CNN to call them Hispanic, but they were all of Algerian descent as well. Coulibaly and the Kouachis had all spent some of their childhood in French orphanages or foster care, as well as prison where they met. Therefore, it is probably just a little bit useful to wonder if the attractions of ISIS to disaffected French youth might not lie in perverse teachings about Islam alone, but in the blowback from France's failed policies of racial and ethnic integration and the scars of its wars in Africa. But what worries me, to sort of bring it back to the United States, is that Cuomo's disturbing mistake reflected not just his own provincialism, but how sloppily race is thought of, both here and abroad. And so in the wake of it, many conservative blogs labeled the outrage over his slip as pure political correctness, musing that if Cuomo had just called Coulibaly black, he'd have somehow been right, and thereby captured Coulibaly's essential being, which is, I guess, the definition of essentializing. And I don't mean that in a nice way. Meanwhile, there is a website called downtrend.com, and they say, because that's the direction of our freedoms, but downtrend.com, ended its Cuomo commentary on this note. The beautiful white actress Charlize Theron is from South Africa, but now lives in the United States. Technically, she's African-American. Oh, true, true. True words were never spoken. However, the malleable stereotyping of Coulibaly reflects, I think, an uneasy vision of blacks, as well as Africans, as non-citizens of any state, of non-citizens of any nation, and always the same wherever they are. And if you just called him black, then it wouldn't matter whether he was Senegalese or Malian or African-American. And I worry that our vocabulary is so broad-brushed when it comes to anyone with very dark skin. Yet it also seems to be a world in where technical African-Americans look like Charlize Theron. We are so analytically and technically committed to exactitude when it comes to, quote, the beautiful white actress. Now, furthermore, racialized American policing strategies, and this is what really concerns me, racialized American policing strategies are increasingly global exports. So in France, debates are now raging about whether to adopt a version of the USA Patriot Act. In addition, technologies of surveillance are automated by algorithms premised on deeply contentious American demographic taxonomies. Rudolph Giuliani, and the reason I mentioned him earlier, is somebody who, you know, has actually said that, you know, there's blood on Mayor de Blasio's hands as well. I mean, he said it's not on Mayor de Blasio's hands. Rudolph Giuliani was much, he aimed for a higher source. He said it wasn't Mayor de Blasio's fault, it's Barack Obama's fault, that shooting. But at any rate, Rudolph Giuliani runs a security company that has global clients, cities, nations, Qatar, Mexico City. Bernie Kerik, you know, despite his criminal record, which keeps mounting every time I look, he's been convicted of something else, but nevertheless has a significant financial interest. Rudolph Giuliani's company alone has an annual income of $40 million. He's got, a salary of $4 million just from his advising. William Bratton, Ray Kelly, they've all become multi-millionaires while traveling the globe, dispensing advice about how to control the unruliness of populations from London to Paris to Mexico City to Seoul. And I think, you know, the European Union certainly has its own problems with race and immigration. I do mean its own. They're locally grown, they're colonially grown, whatever you want to say. But I do fear that they will not be improved by having the entire morning lineup of Fox News as their security advisors. In fact, one glimmer of hope to me in this very messy global moment was the pushback after Fox News's, quote, terrorism experts, Stephen Emerson and Nolan Peterson, asserted that the entire city of Birmingham, England, plus large parts of Paris and London were, quote, totally Muslim with no-go zones where non-Muslims just don't go and where even the police would not dare visit. And British Prime Minister Cameron, no easy liberal, called Emerson an idiot. And the mayor of Paris threatened to sue. But I do worry that we Americans tend to use the concept of freedom of expression as an excuse to say absolutely anything at all, no matter how false in this instance, or threatening, quite frankly, because we're kind of blind, I think, sometimes to the threatening aspect of what gets said, even as we clamp down mercilessly or thoughtlessly when it suits us. So on the one hand, we have Pennsylvania's recently passed re-victimization law, as it's called, allowing prior restraint of speech if it might cause victims of personal injury crimes to experience, quote, the continued effects, including temporary mental anguish. And if that sounds vague, let me tell you exactly why or how this law was passed. It was specifically passed because Goucher College students from which Mumia Abu-Jamal graduated invited Mumia Abu-Jamal, who is in prison, serving a life sentence for killing a police officer. Lots of people believe he's innocent, I'm not going, that's not the issue, he is a prisoner. He was invited to speak about conditions in prison, not to profit from or to talk about the killing of which he's convicted, but to talk from behind prison walls, which I think is a very important voice one needs to hear. And this law was passed because it would apparently upset the family of the man, of the police officer who was killed. Now, again, I think we need to be very, very careful about what is said and how it is said. But the idea that you could actually enjoin somebody from speaking beforehand based on going to the district attorney and seeking said injunction because of the continuing, even temporary as well as permanent, mental anguish that might be invoked, I think is a very dangerous turn for us as a legal matter. Now, on the other hand, some have used the First Amendment to defend the actions of the North Miami Beach, Florida Police Department, whose sharpshooters were discovered using photos of black arrestees for target practice. I don't know if you've seen that. A National Guardswoman was visiting, this happened just a week ago, or 2 weeks ago, a National Guardswoman visiting the range recognized her brother among the images. 15 years ago, he'd been arrested as a teenager for drag racing, and it was a serious accident that resulted. Two people died as a result of it, but he was a minor. It was recklessness, not intentional. It was manslaughter, in other words, not murder. He served 4 years. He has grown up, married, held a job ever since. He's a perfectly respectable citizen since then. But this was his mugshot from 15 years ago. It was put up on the wall, and the photo of his head was riddled with bullet holes. Now, when the National Guardswoman saw her brother like this, and she took it to the police department and then took it to the media, the department responded that they, quote, have to train officers using real faces, that it's, quote, useful to use lineups with faces that share similar characteristics. And after a bit of reflection, they apologized and added that, actually, we also take aim at mugshot lineups of Anglos and mugshot lineups of Hispanics, sort of revealing the segregation even of the mugshot lineups. But what was interesting to me, again, was the online conversation bubbling about whether this was a big deal or whether it was nothing at all. It's just an image. It's like the Danish cartoons. Don't be so politically correct. No actual humans were harmed in the making of these bullseyes. And it worries me. It worries me if one doesn't see what could be potentially wrong with this. And what, you know, there are lots of ways to express what's wrong with it, but it does seem to me, at the very least, if I were to translate it, not just from the fact that you have real people on the walls and you're shooting at them as a kind of loaded suggestion, so to speak, but that it is a kind of perverse iconography. And if we're going to have a global debate about expression and the, you know, the inanimism of images, then that borderline, that image, that provocation that Pope Francis, adorable as he is, when he said, you know, if you talk about my mother, I'm going to punch you, and he gave that cute little punch. You know, but if one is talking about, you know, the sort of emotional response that even just words or images might evoke, this might be a kind of real outlier, a border that we don't want to transgress, that we inform ourselves that maybe this isn't about censorship, this is not about the government, this is about self-restraint, perhaps. But at the same time, this is about the government, this is about a police department who are charged, they have a monopoly of violence. The idea that they have to use real faces as opposed to a bullseye, a real bullseye, seems lost. And I wonder, how does it not break one's heart, those headshots of real black young men, whatever they have done? I don't care if they are in prison, on, you know, in there for life. When you pose these real people for figurative execution, what is it that we are telegraphing? Now, in a very moving response, a largely white group of local clergy in Florida flooded the police with their own photos, launching a Twitter campaign, hashtag #UseMeInstead. Now, I think that, you know, part of the reason that hashtag Black Lives Matter has really caught on in recent years, or in the last few months, half a year, has to do with the fact that it is both ironic and it is literal. And in fact, black lives don't matter so much of the time, but black lives matter. And I hope that the simple, eloquent appeal of hashtag use me instead, and you should really go online and see some of these faces. It really is a very moving display of the clergy. It becomes an invitation to think about who is included or excluded in the deadly yet pliable way we mark boundaries of citizenship and of statelessness, of friend and foe, of human and other, of the unremittingly feared and the eternally forgiven. I keep thinking, again, in terms of the eternally forgiven. Sarah Palin, some years ago, used as part of her campaign advertising bullseyes with various districts, do you recall that, with crosshairs on them. Later, when Gabrielle Gifford was killed, when John Rawl, who was a federal judge, was killed, and Gabrielle Gifford was very severely wounded in the same attack, there was some question about whether the young man, again, somebody who suffered from severe mental illness, who was schizophrenic, untreated schizophrenia, in our society that is awash with guns, Again, I have a great deal more to say about the policy of untreated mental illness in our society and the complete availability of guns, a lethal combination over and over and over again. But we assign agency to these over and over again, and there was a big conversation about whether or not Sarah Palin didn't actually suggest or wasn't the agent of these kinds of attempted assassinations. I rejected that then, I reject it now. On the other hand, I do think we live in a society where the amount of violence, a little bit like watching that French police officer die over and over again, is suggestive. A little bit like the shooting at the mugshots of real human beings is suggestive of something on some deep psychic level, so that when you encounter the real people in the street or anybody who looks like them, you are more cocked and ready to pull that trigger than not. We have lots and lots of neuropsychiatric studies to show that, for example, like or something like the implicit association test, with which I guess most people are probably familiar at this point, where they show faces of blacks and whites in rapid succession with words like good and bad, and the degree to, and they've done a great deal of this with all kinds of groups, you know, men, women, obese, so forth and so on. But when it comes to race, they've actually been using these images to show the degree to which we are all acculturated to be afraid of blackness, of dark skin, to one degree or another, including black people. You know, sort of flinch, you pull the trigger faster. But they have also showed that when you actually use this test appropriately, or the next level of this test, you can actually desensitize people to race, and you can actually make people focus on what somebody is doing or not doing. Would that we would do that in the context of these kinds of, and it seems like the North Florida Police Department was actually doing precisely the opposite of the goal of the implicit association test. They were actually reinforcing that when you see a black face, and particular black faces on the streets, these particular black faces on the streets, you shoot first and ask questions later. Now, one of the things is that I have been writing my column in the last couple of days, and I wanted to write up, in fact, the issue of the North Florida police and their use of these actual mugshots of young men, some of whom were never convicted, some of whom were let go after their arrest, some of whom are convicted, but whatever they did, the idea that you would use them for shooting practice. And one of the things I wanted to point out was that if you reversed it, what if you reversed it? And what if you had citizens online or on Facebook? We've had conversations about what Facebook can censor or not, or what we can put online. But what if, let's not even go that far, because a lot of people have said, well, it wasn't in public, it was just privately. But what if a citizen put up images, and we've had some conversations about some people who are using Barack Obama for target practice or using this or that. But what if you had a line of police officers for target practice? Now, then Patrick Lynch and I would probably be on the same page around this, and you had civilians doing this. Now, I wanted to make that point in my column, and I decided not to. I decided not because I'm afraid that I'd be on Patrick Lynch's bad side, or because I'm afraid of something like the Muslim Brotherhood or whatever, which is a lot of the way in which this gets framed. Are you really not doing it because you're afraid of repercussions? But I do think, again, these questions of how we frame and what we telegraph when we put something out, I think it's enough to talk about what the North Miami Police Department did without driving home the point that if we reversed it, we would have something awful, because it conjures a picture that I don't want to have in my head. I don't want anybody else to have in their heads, whether they have schizophrenia or not, whether it is suggested, whether it's part of the social backdrop of suggestion or not. Mentally stable or unstable, I do worry about a moment, which is the greatest moment of diaspora in human history, and on a globe where we have diminishing resources, on a moment where at a technological revolution, where none of us is really outside of the purview of another, where where police and stalkers alike can track you in real time, where to leave your own path of customary activity gets you flagged by the NSA, or you know, if you read Sherry Turkle at any rate, that means that you violated your own norm. It isn't that you've done anything illegal, but you violated your own path of the normal. And so you you attract attention. Anne Frank will not happen in a future constrained in the way that we are right now. And so therefore, it seems to me that we have to think about ways in which what we telegraph in our words, in our images, whether satirical or serious, are going to be legislated, are going to be permitted. Again, I am somebody who is very, very worried about the degree to which all of our information is being fed into the hoppers of big data. And used to make us into statistical composites rather than to, again, in line with the, both the civil and the criminal jurisprudence of, again, at least American ideology, which is what I have taught for the last 35 years and believe in, which is that you are held accountable for your actions, but not your thoughts. You are held accountable for your incitements, but not your your satire or your clearly non-intentional proposals. That you that even when you make mistakes, even when your actions do make mistakes, that at some point you do your time and you have a chance to change the course of your life. And one of the things that worries me different than what you were, even if you were a criminal, even if you made a mistake. You don't have to be a criminal. If you made a mistake, whether or not you can recoup live that down. Again, I think we are proceeding. This is not just about race. I think that we have taken the lessons of race, the categorizations of race that fed into the eugenics movement, that fed into the ideology of World War II in Europe on both sides of the Atlantic. We have taken the worst aspects of tracking and scientific biologism, mapped them onto a big data framework. And I think that is going to risk the future, again, what in the United States we call, you know, we call ourselves a mobile society. But I think that we are going to become less and less a mobile society if our status is defined by our actuarial projections rather than our human potential. So I'm going to stop here and take questions.
Hi, I'm Lauren Grubel. I'm a second year at SIPA. Thanks so much for coming.
You're welcome.
I have two related questions, and they're both related to your experience at the law school. One was the story that you told about the PhD student at UChicago at the beginning, who's now a professor of science, and wanting to get your opinion on how do we better equip faculty of all disciplines, not just faculty of maybe political science or law, with the skills to lead a conversation on race or on inequality in any of a classroom setting. That's something that we've been thinking a lot about here at SIPA, and I'm sure comes up quite a bit at the law school. And then my second question was more, again, from your perspective at the law school, what do you think of the role of SEPA as a policy school, as kind of a premier policy school in this situation, in situations such as Ferguson or Eric Gardner's grand jury decision, in facilitating or leading conversations? What do you think kind of the realms that we as a school should be pushing, or that we, the types of conversations that we should be creating here?
Let me just answer the second question first, because I actually think, I mean, I really am just delighted to see the kind of schedule of events that you've sort of been reflecting upon here in the school. I mean, I in my conversations and my viewing of the kinds of lecture series that you have, I'm honored to be part of it, but I see this sort of developing, and I hope that, you know, the promise of what I heard described does develop into actual courses. Not just lecture series, but actual courses, that it becomes, and not just separate courses, but that this sort of thing becomes incorporated into every course. I see SEPA obviously as having a big role. I also think that SEPA is aware of the potential for that role. I am not of SEPA, so I think that you could, you know, in a longer conversation, you know, I'd be happy to give suggestions, but I don't want to answer it in the abstract beyond that. The other question is a more intriguing question to me, because I do get asked that a lot. You know, how can, and you phrased it in a way that really did sort of make me think back to this letter I got. Because the person in question is also somebody who is very involved in cutting back or eliminating African American studies, or eliminating, you know, because people who feel as strongly as he does that, in fact, you know, that this is all just a waste of time, particularly at things like public universities, you've probably seen, you know, that the elimination of minority studies, of African American studies, of Latino studies, Chicano studies around the country, is really being accomplished, A, in the name of budget cuts, and B, in the name of, you know, well, there's nothing to be taught anyway. The entire Tucson, Arizona school board did away with a very, very successful, I mean, those kids were all going to college, line of high school study that featured Latin American literature. And when asked, you know, the head of the school board said that, you know, he'd never read it, but he didn't have to. He just knew that it could be eliminated. And so I think that, this is not about, for me, the issue is not training people in other disciplines to lead the conversation about race. It's allowing the conversation always to be interdisciplinary. And it allows people who have gone through a system, and particularly at elite institutions, but not just, you know, elite institutions, but I've taught at public schools, I've taught at smaller schools, I've taught at, you know, elite, and I do think that when one achieves a certain status in life, one has the feeling that, you know, you have nothing left to learn. And that's not just about degrees, it's also about age, it's about, you know, it's about things crystallizing around you. So for me, it's like cracking the eggshell and realizing, no, there actually are things that we live in a world that is changing. It's culturally reconfiguring. It's an enormous, you know, our world is an enormous jigsaw puzzle that is broken apart. We need to either put the pieces back together as they were, which I think is much too late. That's not going to happen in this world. But we need to put them together into a coherent whole that involves a kind of ritual of respect for all the multiple voices that are going on. And that's disciplinary, but it's also cultural, it's also linguistic, it's gestural, it's at so many levels that, it's ideology doesn't even begin to describe it. So I don't, my project is not to train faculty necessarily in disciplines like chemistry, which is what this professor is. To lead a discussion on race. But I do think that it's important to have, you know, that professor, when encountering discomfort from students or overt racism in the classroom, to have the resources and the respect to seek assistance with it. Or to also give pause, not to, you know, to have the ego get in the way of asking students what they mean. Or why did that hurt your feelings if they don't know? But I think that the gesture of instant dismissal, or that doesn't belong in here, take it outside. That's not the formula we're studying today. Is something that is really troubling. I see that in particular. I mean, I teach, again, one part of what I work with, and it'll come again in my class on human identity. But I work well beyond that, which is the way in which, there's this clash of cultures and visual. It's not just about racism. It's not just about interaction. It is about the fact, for example, many people in the biological sciences, in these incredibly wonderfully expanding fields of, biology, of genetics, of population genetics, are looking at data. They're looking at information which is perfectly accurate because they're wonderful scientists. And then they're giving it labels which are raced, or they're giving them labels which have social baggage, and they don't even get it at all. So, for example, I had a conversation with a population geneticist who's a very fine population geneticist. And he has gone and he's looked at, he's actually been able to trace the anterior maternal ancestor in a village in Peru, high in the mountains of Peru. And he can sort of watch the fanning out from that mother through, a whole region. And he says that these people in this village, who are all her descendants, he says they're 100% Native American. And what do you mean by 100% Native American? And it took an hour of talking to this man after his seminar, to get him to understand that when you say 100% Native American, this is a very broad cultural construct. I mean, it involves American, it involves what you mean by Native. When you say 100%, you're implying a kind of racial purity of sorts, particularly as attributed to Native Americanism. 100% Native American means that Inuit are not 100% Native American, that sort of thing. I mean, there are all kinds of implications. So I think that at a deeply, felt level, we're entering a moment in which, the results of, if you watch something like, I know you're having Henry Louis Gates here, so I'm going to be very careful in what I say here. But when he talks about on television in his PBS special, and he tells somebody like Stephen Colbert that he's 100% white, this is really alarming to me because, again, it involves a notion of, or invokes a notion of racial purity. Who is 100% anybody? Anything. Nobody is 100% anything. When you go back, there's simply no such thing. What does he mean by 100%? A white then. What he means is that Stephen Colbert closely matched the data set, the sample against which somebody decided to put the label white, which in fact at that time I believe was something like, it was a very small, it was a few dozen people in Wales. So all it means is that Stephen Colbert is closely related to people in Wales. It doesn't mean that he's 100% anything. It doesn't mean those people in Wales are 100% anything. But, we've reinscribed, it seems to me, particularly through this incredibly burgeoning industry of DNA ancestry tracking, the language of octoroons and quadroons, and, it's like reading Mark Twain, reading some of this stuff, that you're 12% this or 15% that. And again, this is matched data sets. So the figures, actually, when you track it out, the figures of who is 12% this or that have shifted over time because the data sets keep getting larger and larger. And sooner or later, it's true, the data sets, if we include the entire world, we're going to have an accuracy that matches people certainly to their population genetics. But if we have set this up so that people are more or less black or white, then we have matched them to social categories, and we have ultimately achieved what Dr. Mengele couldn't, which is we have biologized race. I think that's a very, very dangerous thing to do. And in fact, what we ought to be doing, and this is again, it seems so simple. What you do is you name the haplotype. You're of this haplotype grouping, and you name it, and you give it something that it doesn't have social construct. Give it a number. Give it a color, not a racial color. Give it a, but give it something that is that defamiliarizes it for this kind of social baggage. Mm-hmm. And I realize that it's two, and some of you have classes, so and it's it's we're on a weird schedule, I guess, because the law school students I know have are in class until for another half hour. So let me give it a pause so people can leave, and I will take it.
My question was pressing on one of your last theses, the need for us to err on the side of leaving open the possibility of forgiveness in our use of forgiving data sets. I want to press on that and just ask, have you ever encountered a data set of predictive power with certain consequences that made you think the opposite, that this is something that we can't ignore?
That what? Give me an example, because I mean, the first thing that comes, I mean, certainly there are predictive indicators, depending upon whether you're talking about genetics. I mean, Huntington's disease, that's 100%.
Right, absolutely.
But so, you know, I don't, but you can't do anything about it as a result. I mean, you're sort of moored in status, so.
I guess something more contentious, something more political, mm-hmm. where we might be able to look to guideposts or principles to delineate where we need to err on the side of forgiveness and where we don't.
Uh-huh. I think that's what law school is all about. I mean, certainly law school is about, you know, providing guideposts for, you know, when you forgive. We call it mitigation. You know, when you mitigate, you know, somebody's acts because of extenuating circumstances. But, you know, for you in policy, it's also about, you know, knowing the data that, for example, leads to, that tends to have a high probability of miserable outcomes. You know, when I look at the history or the life histories of the Quashie brothers, you know, they were, you know, it doesn't take a genius to predict that they were going to be, and they were, you know, in all kinds of petty crime. And you know, and that's what worries me about this moment in time. As you know, this sort of global blow up of whatever, people are not just going to ISIS; they're picking up guns to do anything, because they're available. And we have, and again, just to bring it back to the local, I don't want to talk about what happens in terrorism. There are lots of discussions, and there may be indicators that, you know, I don't want to take it outside of my range of familiarity, but certainly in the United States. We know that when you put somebody in solitary confinement, you know, and they're a minor, you can break their spirits forever, right? And there's a pretty good chance that you're going to get it. It's close to, you know, we've seen that. That's part of the scandal of what's happened in Rikers Island. And when you release those people into the world and you give them no other social services, except drugs and guns, then we have endangered all of our polity. So, it's hard to answer in the abstract, but I don't know whether you're hinting at the kind of, you know, debates that have gone on involving people like Alan Dershowitz. You know, we see, you know, the trolley car. You know, where we, you know, which to me argues, you know, an ethic of triage. You know, that you simply write certain people off. You divide the world into threes, and you write certain people off because their statistics are simply too awful, and therefore you you let them go, or you put them in jail, or you don't let them out. And that's fine if those are the only options you have, and there's really something immediate. But what worries me, if again that was your point, and again I'm sort of extrapolating here, but if that's your point, what worries me is that we have reconfigured all of our policy based on a shortage of resources. We don't want to pay. We want to cut taxes, and we want to be able to have people who can be autonomous individuals at no cost. And therefore, on the one hand, we're biologizing perfect babies, and on the other hand, we're throwing the throwaway babies into trash bins. That's really what Rikers is at this point. And you know, we could have a different outcome if we were having a conversation that didn't make it seem as though the immediate threat is that, you know, if we let them out, they're going to shoot us and our society will end as we know it. But instead, is what if we took, you know, some percentage of this or that budget, I won't mention the defense budget, but, you know, if instead we really took these people and invested in their educational future as much as, I mean, so again, it's what you do with those probabilities. Yes, I can see somebody born into poverty with no educational to somebody whose parents are both incarcerated have very few life chances. The question is, then what future do you invest in as a policy matter? If it's prison, you know, I think that, you know, that's terrible. If, in fact, you think that there's possibility, human possibility, that's where I'd invest it. You know, the other dimension of what you invoke, however, is, of course, the European Union's decision to have a right to forgiveness in terms of, which came out of their criminal law, which is coming up as a question of censorship or not. That is to say, whether or not you can actually take off the internet somebody's background of debt or criminality or whatever by saying, you know, they've done their time, let's expunge. It's the equivalent of expungement, but because it involves a global network, are we going to be able to do that? Can we do that as a practical matter? And I think that's an interesting question, because if, in fact, we were not in a time of this technological change, expunging records is not that controversial. But Google, as a private company, doesn't want to pay for the expense and the and it goes zillions of places when it's on the internet. How do you take all of that off? Is it like, you know, suppressing a collective memory? Is it like burning your archives? And we haven't, you know, that's a debate I can't settle.
So I found it very interesting. I had not heard this expression before of the actuarial self, or you know, the fact, as you said, that maybe when someone sees someone, you're sort of seeing like a statistical set of probabilities that says this person may be doing that or that. I hadn't heard that expression, although that idea exists and is out there in the sense that one may say, you know, because a person has these characteristics, we'll infer that about them or so on. Mm-hmm. Is it your sense? So, I mean, one of the troubling aspects of that, of course, is that that can induce that person, in fact, sometimes to take actions that sort of fulfill these things.
Yeah.
Would that require that our measurement of these things become more precise? So, because if we're gaining precision, partially because of the data aspects that, at sort of saying when we see a person, we have a better actuarial map of what this person might do, then that suggests that then, you know, we should have greater safeguards against what can happen. Because if we say that there's more precision when the police see someone at the airport to think this may happen, then maybe we need to put in greater safeguards that doesn't let that happen, that, you know, that basically restrains this type of discrimination from happening. Is it your sense that this is a discussion that happens in the law, which is something,
yes,
I don't know? And yeah, is it couched in the terms of increased precision? Is that,
yes,
something that comes up?
And it's very interesting. I mean, that's why I'm such a big believer in interdisciplinary. I am not a social scientist. I am certainly not a geneticist. I am not, you know, I'm not many things in the social sciences. I was trained as a lawyer. But some of the most interesting work I see coming is from people like Jerry Kang, if you're interested, K-A-N-G. And he teaches at UCLA. And he is a lawyer, but he's principally a social scientist. And so he's been collecting a lot of data of the sort, tracking what happens with things like the implicit association test. And he has devised, proposed a metric whereby, for affirmative action, and I don't know if you know that Sandra Day O'Connor once said, you know, well, we don't know how long we're going to need affirmative action, but let's say 25 years, and, you know, and so at 25 years precisely, people have started cutting back on affirmative action, regardless of any data about whether or not, in fact, data to the contrary, that certain forms of discrimination and segregation in schools has done nothing but increase. What he says is that you can actually do brain scans and show when people are still responding to the triggers of racism, or, you know, when they look at somebody and they see them rather than you or singular, they see a plural instead of singular. You can actually track this, and you can see it in their responses to things like the AIT test, and so that our measure, our temporal period, should be coordinated to the data of when a majority or a plurality of people no longer flinch throughout society, or respond, or if not flinch, then when the response to black and white faces, or men and women's faces, becomes equal. That would be a data-driven metric of equality. It's, again, not a traditional jurisprudential one, but I think that those sorts of things I find intriguing and interesting.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was
Thank you.
So I'm wondering if you could comment on sort of the third piece of the puzzle that you've laid out here. You have your legal framework, we have our social science framework for understanding these issues of race and policy, but there's also the media piece, and as a columnist, you have a piece of that also. So. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. As the mayor's doing, frankly, to start addressing what's, you know, this actuarial self that's emerging, and that understood this way, but you framed very well. The piece of the puzzle that I find most troubling at this point, and that impacts both what the law is able to do and what the social scientists are able to do to impact policy, is this media piece, which has been transformed dramatically, of course, by the internet and bloggers and this whole. Like every, you can say anything, there's no fact checking, and there's no filter. And so, the public, it seems, from social science research, seems to be sort of just getting their misinformation reinforced by, you know, mm-hmm. watching Fox if they're conservative or CNBC if they're liberal, or, you know, just reading The Nation and not reading anything else. So, I'm wondering if you've been thinking about that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, at least one of my students has been in my law, media, and public policy class, which, and I'm very frustrated. I don't know how to answer that question. I mean, but I do think that, you know, in the last 20 years or so, you have, you know, I mean, and it wasn't always this way in the United States, but certainly, you know, the function of the media ideologically, at any rate, the National Enquirer notwithstanding, was as, you know, as a kind of, you know, as holding government accountable. And so that it was both a part, but it was also, you know, an add-on estate, you know, and it was really to hold the republic to its best, to inform. You know, whether it did that effectively or not, it certainly is a far cry from what's happening now. What's very interesting to me is the death of ethical codes. And that's why, you know, I was going in my own mind when I was trying to decide, I have the right, I can say anything I want to, but do I really want to reverse this as a fantasy, put it into words and serve it up to the public? Do I need to do that? Do I need to, you know? Until very recently, you know, and the New York Times and the Washington Post still have very, very detailed ethical codes about what they will or will not do and the responsibility to represent for various communities, as well as to do the kind of investigative reporting that really has led. It wasn't the mayor's office. It was the New York Times that did the investigative reporting if we have any potential of changing Rikers, it's because of them. That's what a good newspaper does. The BBC, you know, for all of its flaws and its failures, it is a good, reliable news source because it has a code of ethics to which it, by and large, lives up. I mean, all kinds of scandals, but it still, by and large, lives up to it. When you look at Fox News or the internet, I mean, you know, everybody's a blogger, everybody's a journalist, there is no ethical code. Fox News is actually not a news organization in the traditional sense of NBC or CBS or some of the original television stations. And when you look at actually its corporate structure, Fox News is not news. It's not part of News Corp, I think, which is what it was in London. It is a subsidiary of Fox Entertainment. So it's an entertainment organ. It has repeatedly said, you know, when it's been accused of falsehoods, it says, you know, we you know, we live in a country with the First Amendment. Now, I don't know what it says in Britain. I don't know what it says, you know, in other places where Rupert Murdoch has other holdings. But that's been its line in the United States. You know, the First Amendment allows you to lie about all kinds of things. I mean, you can only really be held if you pretend to be somebody else and write a check in their name. You know, I mean, it's really, even our defamation, slander, and stuff, it's really, it's very hard to bring a suit against an organization like them. So I think, you know, the First Amendment is the outside on what we can or cannot say, is to many, you know, sort of ultra-libertarians a great success. It seems to me it's not necessarily healthy for a civil society. It is precisely the opposite of that. It's incivility. And that involves a kind of self-restraint and perhaps some sort of organized restraint. That's why I believe that ethical codes have a powerful place in a society that works. They are less than actual laws saying you can or cannot say this, but they are agreements among people in particular, and therefore you can turn to a profession, and it is defined by, you know, you can trust that this is what they are going to say or not say. But they are somewhat more voluntary. So I'm a big believer in the ethics of journalism, even as I appreciate, and that's why I'm terribly worried about the Pennsylvania law 508, the victimization law. It's a law with, you know, you get punished and enjoined if you violate it. But I also do think that the ethical codes are something we need to incorporate into our rituals of civic regard. And I don't. Again, I am not a policy expert. I don't know how to do this. I just sound the alarm because I don't see us. I think at some point we are clearly going, but I look at the internet as a kind of civic space. You know, we're not out in the streets anymore. We are in the internet. And the amount of harassment, the amount of, stalking, the amount of violent words that goes on makes a lot of people afraid. It may be First Amendment, but it's frightening people. It's frightening, you know, particularly women, particularly people of color. You may have seen this race swap thing that was. It got, you know, where this woman she blogs under a white face, a white male face, and she gets all kinds of engagement and conversation. She says the same thing with her picture. She's a black woman, and when she puts her face on it on the same blog, she gets death threats. So what do we do in a world where death threats are just First Amendment? I am very, very worried about, you know, how we regulate that, how we can, somebody was saying, it was in today's newspaper, and it was the fear of the Jewish community in France. I think it's on today's BBC website, and they were talking about the fact that you know, if only a very small, like 1% of the Muslim world, and it was a, you know, you'd have to look at the math of this to make sure that this wasn't, you know, you can manipulate these statistics all kinds of, but if only 1% are violent jihadists who also are vehemently anti-Semitic, by that calculation, it was 15 million, but that's more than the entire population of Jews in the, you know, and so this sense of terror, of fear, you know, of who you are. You know, if, you know, I'm thinking, you know, African Americans are 13% in the United States, and if, you know, at this point apparently 70% of white people in the United States feel Eric Garner and, you know, these police officers are good people doing their job, and, you know, if we're arguing in different worlds, if our, you know, all of this supposed connectivity of the internet is not connecting us somehow. It's not allowing us to experience each other's vulnerability. So if interconnection, I think, has been a cipher for freedom of expression, but I think this level of interconnectivity is also related to extreme vulnerability, and how we balance those is, you know, another, maybe it's just another way of saying freedom and security, but I think it's more nuanced than the way in which we're handling it, which is, again, this triage thing. You know, we either live in bunkered communities with walls and guns at the posts or prisons. There must be some way in which we can negotiate the vulnerability of who we are in a world where we have no secrets and no, you know, where not all of us want to wear armor and carry guns. Oh, I'd be delighted. I will come to all of the other ones as well.